This is a review of the material that we have already gone over in class. That is the second part of what we're going to be talking about, is Nietzsche's philosophy in the tragic age of the Greeks, the ancient philosophers. And the first part of what we're going to be talking about is Aristotle, the metaphysics. You can see that behind me. To go over, as some people have asked me, that I might go over some of the slides. And they can be useful. Once again, this is not a hybrid class, and this is not an online or Zoom class. So this is just meant to be a review for the sake of the midterm and also for the sake of understanding. The text is available. It is the Ross translation that you can find in every man's library. Of Aristotle's metaphysics. He was born, we went over this in class, 384 BCE. He's a Stagirite in Stagira, and that is Macedonia. His father was the court physician of Philip, king of Macedonia, father of Alexander of Macedonia, Alexander the Great, because he would conquer the world, including Greece, including Athens. 322 BCE is where he died. We know him also, we went through this, and we're always going to go back to this again, because this is Raphael, the school of Athens. And here, where Plato was talking about ideas, we just went over in class when we will maybe have a review session. I hope we will have a review session on the Republic. But we talked about the forms. We talked about the form of the good, the idea, the ideal of the good that is for Plato more real than the appearances of things, which are, after all, as appearances, just seeming. They're not really, really real. The essence of things, what makes them what they are, being the idea, the knowable aspect of the thing, in this case, the good, which is what Plato was talking about, or the ideal of justice. And Aristotle has very, very good similar concerns, but he himself is more interested in the question of causality, what and how things come to be as they are. And here, where Plato points to the heaven of ideas, he's holding the Timaeus, which is, of course, a dialogue with the astronomer Timaeus. Aristotle's holding the ethics, ethica, and that is how to be a human being and is very much concerned with the nature of the human. We also talked a little bit earlier about, when we started out a class, we started out with Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics and his distinction between what makes a human being specifically human as opposed to mere life, bare life, as Agamben would say, that is mere nutrition or growth, because plants can also, and they do also, take in nutrition from the environment and they grow. From also the life of perception, or the life of experience, awareness, sensation, that life of perception or sentient awareness being very much shared by animals who are also very aware of their environment, very conscious, who perceive the world around them, to what specifically human, uniquely human in human life, and that is the life of reflection, the life of contemplation, thinking, the kind of thing that we're doing in philosophy. And Aristotle begins the metaphysics. This text is, you can read along if you want on the MIT website, just book one, part one, or book alpha, as it's called, where Aristotle just clarifies what by nature we want, and that's also where this reflective element comes in, because we don't desire necessarily to eat alone. We might, man does not live, we say, by bread alone, or to have sensual experiences, but we do desire to know, whether we're philosophers or not, we desire to know, all human beings by nature. He says men, but this really can be broadened to any human being. An indication of this is the delight, he says, we take in our senses, for even apart from their usefulness, their love for themselves, and above all others, the sense of sight, for not only with a view to action, but even when we're not going to do anything, we prefer seeing, we want to see for ourselves, as one can say, to everything else. The reason is, and that's why the internet is such a success, that most of all the senses, it is seeing that allows us to know. We really think we know something when we've seen it, and it brings to light many differences between things. Aristotle is making that distinction that we already saw in the Nicomachean Ethics, to which he refers in the Metaphysics. So the Nicomachean Ethics is written first, or certainly precedes this text. Animals other than the human live by appearances and memories and have but little of connected experience. The human race lives also by art. Now, the word that Ross translates as art is sometimes translated as science or knowledge or skill by other translators, because the Greek word is techne, which is also a word that obviously could be rendered in terms of technique or technology. So the human race lives by art. And that's one of the ways we define the human being in terms of the human being's tools and reasonings. Now, if we look at the way he continues, he goes on to say that experience is going to be the product of memory. We remember how something went at one point, and we apply that memory of how things were solved or how things were done to a future event or a current event. And of course, that's means that we get a capacity for single experience, because we're able to even experience something because we remember having encountered it before. So experience seems to be like science, which would be episteme, knowledge, and art, but really it's going to be science and technology or technique that are going to come to human beings from experience, because experience is going to be the author of art. But inexperience, the lack of it, if we happen to have success, that's going to be luck, because it'll be a success by chance alone. Now, what we have then, as he continues, is to talk about how that technique, how that art, how that skill arises. And that will lead to this ability to make a judgment about a class of objects. So, and here the reference is to a physician, to have a judgment that when Callias was ill, of this disease, this remedy, for example, did him good. Similarly, in the case of Socrates and in many individual cases, that's going to be a matter of experience. You've done this before, you've learned from experience, and on the basis of experience, you have a judgment. But this is the distinction that's made, to judge that it's done good to all persons. And here's this universal claim that's necessary. Persons of a certain constitution marked off in one class, when they were ill of this disease, for example, phlegmatic or bilious people when burning with fevers, that's a matter of art. Next slide, with a view to action, experience seems in no respect inferior. And it seems to be that men of experience succeed even better than those who have theory without experience. The claim will be made that you're going to have experience, but he's still going to claim that theory is a little bit of an advantage. Why? Because we take the word artists here is the technites, the persons of skill, the persons who have technique. We're going to assume that they are the ones who are wiser than people who have just and only experience. One more time, because you're going to need wisdom. And that's because the person who has the technology, the techne, the technique, the art, the skill in understanding, that person is going to have recourse to the cause. Those people who just have mere experience don't have that access. So the distinction, notice the way the argument is set up. Here is our definition. Human beings of experience, men of experience, know that the thing is so, but they don't know why, while the others know the why and the cause. So beyond the person of experience, they're going to know that something is the way that it is, but they don't know the why. And knowing the why is really crucial, but also that means knowing the cause, knowing how it comes about. So that's what one is looking for. And the continuation of the claim is that manual workers, those who are just the ones who are maybe hired to do a task, but don't necessarily understand the reasons why they're doing it, they are not going to have the full knowledge of that, say, maybe an engineer might have, or that a master architect might have. So the laborers perform them through habit. They've always done it this way, but they don't know why they do it. So that's going to be, as he says, a sign of the man who knows and the man who doesn't know. The former can teach, the one who understands the why, the one who understands the cause, can explain the why and can point to the cause and also obviously draw conclusions on the basis of that, that someone who just has experience isn't really going to be able to do because they're limited to the experience that they have. So artist, the word, I put the Greek here for because it can be helpful, the technites, so you can see we're talking about a technician, someone who has skill, that's the person who can teach, but the person who just has experience but doesn't have skill in that regard, not doesn't have the art of it, as it were, that person won't be able to teach. Now, he refers to his ethics, which we all already read, at least the section that mattered. So here the question is, and In the ethics, there's a distinction made already between art and science. But here, the only question is the wisdom and the idea of philosophy, which is just dedicated here, he says, to first causes and principles. That's it. So if you get, and here he's not disagreeing with Plato, if you're interested in the essence of things, all things, you're interested in first causes, you're interested in their principles, meaning you're interested in their forms. So it's been said before, the person of experience is thought to be wiser than the possessors of any sense perception whatever. And in this sense, the artist is wiser than a person of experience, the master worker, wiser than the mechanic, and the theoretical kinds of knowledge, which is what he's going to be writing about in the metaphysics itself, that obviously would be more the nature of wisdom than productive or effective or efficient understanding. So then, wisdom is knowledge of, quick summary, certain principles and causes. And by cause, he means something very technical. In fact, the first part of the metaphysics is all about that notion of cause. So he then takes us as we look through the next section, and we're just reading through this first section a little slowly, just to understand it. The wise man knows all things as far as possible without, and that's important, he doesn't have to know them in all detail. The one who's able to do this will be the one who can learn things that are difficult and not easy to know. So sense perception, taking a look, is easy, but that by the same token also means that just taking a look is not a sign of wisdom. Anyone can take a look. So the further point, though, is the one that Plato spends an enormous amount of time in the Republic trying to illustrate, as we saw. We didn't mention this when we were talking about this because we did this earlier, but at the review, we can also, since we've just done Plato's Republic, we can refer to that, because the whole point of this is to say why it's going to be better to listen to the philosopher rather than someone who just claims to know or who has a vague sense of himself as someone people should listen to because he wants to rule, but rather that someone who has this kind of understanding is really the one one should listen to. That is to say, the less wise should obey him. And that's almost really a repetition of what Plato argues in the Republic. For Aristotle, the whole point here is that wisdom, science, knowledge are things one pursues for their own sake. So you're not pursuing them for the sake of something else, which would make them ancillary, would make them lesser or dependent kinds of knowledge. And that means you're really not going to be able to pursue wisdom, science, and knowledge until you've gotten practical matters out of the way. So things that you need for comfort or survival, or things that you want for entertainment, those things belong somewhere else. Rather, the human being, and this is really also the definition or the source of what we call liberal arts, or BA, if you get a Bachelor of Arts, you're pursuing a liberal education, free education is what that means. Nothing's forced on you. You choose freely because you're able to pursue purely on the basis of what knowledge is valuable for its own sake, because you don't need it for anything. And just because of that, we've mentioned this already, you really can apply it in many, many, many constellations. Now, I'm going to skip a little to this next slide. Three, causes are spoken of, he says, in four senses. And this fourfold definition of causality is something that philosophers who study Aristotle go over again and again. It's complicated, and so it's right here. He's got it all in this one paragraph, but it doesn't mean that having gone through this, we're going to understand it completely. But let's start. Causes are spoken of in four senses, and he begins by talking about the substance, the, if you could certainly say, what would count as the substantial, if you like, the essence. The why is reducible finally to the definition, and the ultimate why would be cause and principle. And another, this is another contribution to the cause, or another contributive source for causation, would be the material. That would be the substrate or the substratum. And then the third is your moving cause. That would be your source of change. And in a fourth, the cause opposed to this, in a certain sense, this is regarded as the ultimate cause for Aristotle. That's the purpose, the good of a thing. And the asterisk points to the Greek there. You can see telos. Telos would be the key. Now, here we have this, the Greek expression, theoretikes, minga telos aletheia, where the claim is, and that's metaphysics, and there's the Greek, you can find that, 993b22. The progress of philosophy merges with that of truth. Why? Because the end, the theoretical end, minga telos aletheia, is truth. So that's what we're looking for. And each of his predecessors, Chernus, and you can look at that extra text, it's available in the library. Each of his predecessors was aiming at the goal represented by his own system. So Chernus looks at what Aristotle is doing in his discussion of cause, whereby Aristotle immediately proceeds to talk about what the fundamental essence of things, the substantial, if you like, everything is made of, or of a material, of sort of essential quality, with regard to the goal represented by his own system. So one of the, that's a critical claim, because what Chernus is arguing is that Aristotle is using his own lens in order to evaluate all of the other thinkers. And you may have noticed that when you were reading and going along. Aristotle's student Theophrastus is to a certain, well, it's actually to a large extent our source for the pre-Socratic philosophers. And in some respects, it's significant to realize that that also means that Aristotle, in a way, is also the source. Certainly, we have one of the first overviews of these thinkers. Again, we have Theophrastus. This is a kind of more sort of bombastic look of a Theophrastus, if we like, because this Theophrastus is very medieval. No accident there. It's almost a dura representation. Here's another Theophrastus, as we know, looks a little more noble, a little more Greek. And we see Theophrastus here on his deathbed, very influential as he was. Now, go back again to what we started with, right? The first principles of things. This is the arche. The idea of something at its inception, the idea that there is going to be a first element. That's a first principle, as he says, that's the meaning of arche, and it's that from which all things come to be. That's, in every case, their first principle. That's what Chernus means. Aristotle, looking for first principles in all of the pre-Socratic thinkers, is looking for what they understand to be pretty much what he thinks to be the main thing, namely that they all in some sense have to have an arche that they're talking about, and he will then identify that and tell us what that is. But Chernus is pointing out that that is a little bit of a leading clarification, and Aristotle himself is sort of discovering in all of the thinkers that he then proceeds to review really something in accord with his own presupposition. This is always a problem when we look at anything, we can bring our own presuppositions to it. So we've got to be a little careful or critical of our presuppositions. Guthrie picks up a similar point, reminding us that in another case, there's a question of what that first principle would be, looking at mimesis as acting, to emphasize that imitating something or echoing or repeating something was originally religious. So the Pythagoreans were primarily religious, Dionysian religious worship, and you'll see some of that in Nietzsche's discussion, involves a supposed identity of the worshippers with Bacchus. Bacchus is another name for Dionysus himself and his divine attendants, and Pythagorean beliefs, which is also a mystical, even though we think associate Pythagoras with mathematics, Pythagorean beliefs were in the full stream of such religious ideas. That's why numbers, also associated with music, are also divine. So mimesis might well have meant for the Pythagoreans what we or Aristotle would call identity, and then of course number would fit into that. Now here's our Thales. I went through that a little bit too quickly. Thales ho milesios, and we typically regard him as the first philosopher. Now Nietzsche, not in this text, but in his lecture courses at the university, reminds us that Laertius himself, who's telling us that Thales is the first philosopher, is also telling us where he comes from. We saw that just there. Ho Milesios, he is of Miletus. And we hear that from Herodotus, Thales of Miletus. And we hear that he's a Phoenician, he's got Phoenician in his background, and Clement says he's a Phoenician by birth. But Nietzsche clarifies to his students that the judgment of the majority is that he's a native Milesian, purebred almost, pure blood, as it were, namely from the Thalidae, who produced the likes of Duris and Democritus, and that clarify who his father and his mother were, the son of Examius and Cleopulain. So there he is for us, or we could say maybe, because we really don't know. We have Euclid, Archytas, Archimedes, all these figures, which we are speculating, because as I've emphasized, anytime you find a website online telling you who all of these figures are, they're making it up, because we don't know. Raphael never told us. We're supposed to know, we're meant to recognize, but we don't always. Certainly we can see elements of what's being illustrated. Certainly there's diagramming that's taking place. And we know that the properties of triangles, and that seems that we're looking here, right there with a, what would be a compass to measure angles, and Thales is said to be one of those who discovers the properties of the isosceles triangle. So could be Euclid, who also has diagrams and triangles, or Archytas, who uses this in order to plot the literal dimensions of the earth, or Archimedes, and we know something about his technical discoveries. Or Thales, could be Thales, that guy could be Thales, hard to say. So our challenges, and Nietzsche continues this for us, not in the text we're looking, again, this is from a text that is based on his lecture notes, so that would be Nietzsche's review for his students, his notes. Who was he? Who was Thales? What were his origins? We already saw some of that. We already heard the pedigree, and we get again this question of his date. So one of the interesting things about Thales is we have a very precise date, and we have a very precise date, and we've had it since the 19th century, because we know that he predicts a particular eclipse. Two definite opinions. First, we've got the testimony of Demetrius, I'm sorry about that, of Phalerum in the List of Archon, which cited, and Nietzsche himself is referring to his own last week, just like we just referred to this, or at least I'm mentioning our experience as a class of having gone through Plato already, but prior to this review, which won't be posted until a little later, just so that you'll have it for reference. So Nietzsche goes on to say that the list that's produced, the List of Archon, proclaims Thales a sage. So Thales named a sage. And actually that's what the lecture course in question, he just lists all of those who are called wise, all of those who are said to have wisdom. And the second opinion, point that has to be clarified, the not opinion, but point, is, I misread that, is owing to an eclipse predicted, quote, during the reign of the Lydian king Aliates. Okay, and Nietzsche explains that given that Apollodorus sets his birth in the 35th Olympiad, that would make Thales 55 years old at the time of the eclipse. But whenever he was born, however old he would have been, you certainly know that he would have been alive at the time of the eclipse. So we've got that date and we can backdate it to the time of his birth and then maybe project a little bit to the time of his death with certainty. So once again, we see him with his triangles one more time. Thales we see, Thales or Milesios. And Aristotle says different things. Aristotle says that Thales, the founder of this type of philosopher, says it's water. We already had some little droplets there, getting the notion maybe from saying that the nutriment of all things is moist and that heat itself is generated from the moist and kept alive by it. So there is a certain sense in which you really need certain aspects to maintain or preserve the heat. And that from which they come to be is a principle of all things. So that could be from that fact, but also the fact that seeds of all kinds have a moist nature, including a reproduction, and that water is then the origin of the nature of moist things. So Aristotle summarizes, and here we have a graphic for that. Thales says that it, that's the arche, that's going to be the nature of all things. Aristotle's principle that he's discovering here is water. Thales says it's water. So the arche is available for all of these thinkers, for Thales, it will be water. Now, there's a very nice reflection because he adds then that this isn't just Thales, it has an antecedent because those who first framed accounts of the gods, you could think he's referring to Hesiod, had a similar view of nature, for they made ocean, Okeanos, and Tethys, the parents of creation, and describe the oath of the gods as being by water, to swear by water, to which they give the name of Styx, that will be the underground river of the dead, for what's all last is most honorable, and the most honorable thing is that by which one swears. You're going to take an oath on something that is honorable or holy. And here we have Okeanos, or ocean, these primal parents, and Tethys. Okay. Some think that the soul pervades the whole universe, whence perhaps came Thales' view that everything is full of gods. Now, what's interesting, of course, is that there are examples of this, because Thales is also one of the discoverers of static electricity, amber, cat's fur and things like that. And thus one can explain, this is Aristotle's explanation, not in the metaphysics, but in De Anima concerning the soul, where he again refers to Thales' view, as we see that everything is full of gods. There are these moving forces in everything. And Thales also is referring to magnetism, the lodestone, so whereby something that looks like a rock can attract. There's a discussion of some of this if you're interested and want to maybe major in philosophy or maybe in classics. And G.E.R. Lloyd has a book, Early Greek Science, which goes very instructively from Thales to Aristotle. Aristotle then goes on to talk about Anaximenes and Diogenes, because Anaximenes and Diogenes are going to talk about water as the prime principle, so prior to water, and as the most primary of the simple bodies, while Hippasus of Metapontium and Heraclitus, we're going to talk about him a little more in a moment, is going to say it's fire. Empedocles will say that it's the four elements, so air and, of course, also fire and water. So those would be the three, in addition to which he adds earth. For Empedocles, four elements. For these, he says, always remain. Everything can be reduced to that and don't come to be except that. They come to be more or fewer, being aggregated into one and segregated out of one. You can see that logical claim. Then Anaxagoras of Clazomenae, who, though older than Empedocles, was later in his philosophical activity, so lived longer and was more creative later in life, says that the principles are infinite in number, Anaxagoras. For he says, almost all the things that are made of parts like themselves. So there's a bit of everything in everything, little homoes, as Anaxagoras says, little seeds of things in everything, in the manner of water or fire, generated and destroyed in this way only by aggregation, a kind of condensation and segregation, a kind of rarefication, becoming more ethereal, and are not in any other sense generated or destroyed, but remain eternally. So they're always there. It's a matter of concentration, thinning one or the other. Now, cause then takes Aristotle to reflection one more time on this usual way of thinking about cause. Based on that, he says, you could think it's just the matter. That would be the material cause. But as men thus advance, the very facts open the way for them and join in forcing them to investigate. This is kind of the invention of science, because however true it may be that all generation and destruction proceed from someone, or for that matter, from maybe one element or elements, why does this happen and what is the cause? Why? For at least the substratum itself does not make itself change. So if the substratum, the material out of which it's made, is wood or bronze, that's not going to be what causes the change or transformation. And wood certainly doesn't manufacture a bed, and bronze certainly, obviously, you could parallel structure that the same way, doesn't make the statue, but something else brings that about. That means something else is the cause of the change. So if things are transformed, you're going to need to have another contributing element that is part of the cause. And to seek this is to seek a second cause, and that's really going to be the motion which will bring about how what comes into being comes to be. That's going to be the beginning of the movement. And those who at the very beginning set themselves to this inquiry, they're going to say that it's one. They weren't dissatisfied, but some at least who maintain it to be one, that is the real reference here is to Parmenides, can find themselves defeated by the search for a second cause, because Parmenides also has to say that the one doesn't admit any change, because you want to exclude the second, so that they say the one and nature as a whole is unchangeable. So there's anything else, just appearance, and you can see that there's a little connection with Plato, and that's what, not only in respect of generation and destruction, for this is a primitive belief, meaning they all would think that, but also of all other change, because Parmenides is going to exclude it, and that view is peculiar to them. He's mentioning it, he's not going further into that here. So, but we get in our next sentence a fuller description of the most prominent representative. Of those who said the universe was one, none really succeeded except Parmenides, because he also is the father of logic and he has a great argument as well as a very, very long poem in which he makes his case. He only inasmuch as he supposes that there is not only one, but also in some sense two causes. And that's a kind of a sneaky thing, because actually that's what Parmenides wants to exclude. And you can see that is he more interested in those where there's a plurality, because for those who make more elements, it's more possible to state the second cause, making hot and cold, fire and earth, because that difference is really going to be a dynamic difference. They treat fire as having a nature which fits it to move things. So you're going to get a kind of a moving cause and water and earth and such things they treat in the contrary way. Now, I've got this here in this section, just as a really screenshot of the text that you can see, which I've added 4 to that, so you can know that it's book 4, because he then goes to Anaxagoras, who's speaking of mind, nous, that is reason. Reason is a deus ex machina for the making of the world, which will be reason that will do this, and it will then, therefore, the world have a reason. But the trouble is the trouble of ascribing necessity to that, so that he really uses reason to make sense of things by saying that they're in accord with reason. In the same way, Empedocles, using causes to a greater extent, is really sufficient or consistent, and then uses the attraction between things, that's called love here, that will then, in this particular case, cause them in a certain sense sometimes to be repelled and strife sometimes will cause things, because you can get very stressed out if there's a lot of strife, and that can lead you to want to come together again. Is it makeup sex? So for whenever the universe is dissolved into its elements by strife, fire is aggregated into one, and so is each of the other elements. But whenever again, under the influence of love, they come together into one, the parts must again be segregated out of each element, and so they are drawn away from one another. So it's sort of like positive and positive. You can almost see the beginnings of atomic theory. And Empedocles, contrast to his predecessors, was the first to introduce the dividing of this cause, not positing one source, but different and contrary sources, and of course a great circular and developing motion. He's the first to speak, and that he had already mentioned, so he says again, of the four material elements, but he doesn't use four, but mostly he speaks of the two only, speaking of fire by itself and its opposite, being earth, air, and water as one kind of thing. Okay. We proceed, we're still in four, to the philosopher speaking of his principles in this way and made them of this number. So Leucippus, these are the atomists, and his associate Democritus say the full and the empty are the elements, calling the one being and the other non-being. That would be the full, talking about the plenum, and solid being, and the empty non-being. So because, of course, very much also the source of nature abhorring a vacuum, and that's why they'll say, see the parenthesis, being no more is than non-being, because the solid no more is than the empty, and they make these, this the material causes of things, very atomistic way of thinking. And as those who make the underlying substance one generate all of the things by modifications of that underlying substance, and the same thing with the rare and the dense also as sources of the modifications, the philosophers are then going to be able to say the differences in the elements could be the causes of all the other qualities. The differences then are going to be three: shape, order, and position. And he gives you an illustration of that just to show that for these thinkers, the real is differentiated only by rhythm and intercontact and turning, how things are rotated. And you can actually think that there are elements of that also in subatomic theory to this day. And of these, rhythm is shape, intercontact, order, and turning is position. And his illustration is AN and AN versus NA and M, obviously, when you invert it, by changing the position of it. So we have a quote, and I think I have an illustration, AN, obviously how things are arranged, the A and the N, put the A first, the N second, and so on and so forth. And we can see a little bit better if we look at the Greek to understand how the eta and the zeta are related, because you can see if it's written in lowercase that that's definitely related, eta and zeta. And we turn then after that to Pythagoras. Pythagoras is a name we know, we learned it in school, of course, but it's also an example that is used here because the so-called Pythagoreans, this is now book five, the book Alpha, section five, let's be clear, section five, who were the first to take up mathematics. They not only advanced it, obviously that's what the Pythagorean theorem is all about, but it's also the relationship of the chord and the monochord, or proportions, and really the Pythagoreans invented ratios. So if you had any trouble with fractions, you can blame the Pythagoreans. So having been brought up in it, they thought its principles of mathematics and mathematical relations or ratios were the principles of all things. There was a number, and that's pretty much the claim that's made, numerically expressed, when you see here again, and this is Aristotle's summary of what one can also see in the Lawson video, The First World, with regard to some of the musical illustrations. So they saw that the modifications and the ratios of musical scales were expressible in numbers. And therefore, they supposed the elements of numbers to be the elements of all things, and the whole heaven to be a musical scale and a number. And that's, of course, also, although we did not get to this, how Plato ends the Republic. All the properties of numbers and scales, which they could show to agree with the attributes and parts and the whole arrangement of the heavens, they collected and fitted into this scheme. And if there were any problems with the way that scheme worked, they're mathematicians after all, they just made additions to make it come out mathematically even. That is, to make the whole theory coherent. And a lot of scientists will do that. So if something doesn't work in your theory, you can see if there's some other thing that you can add to make it work. And he gives an example, e.g., there's the number 10 is thought to be perfect and to comprise the whole nature of numbers. They say, the Pythagoreans say, that the bodies which move through the heavens are 10. But it's the visible bodies, there's a problem with what you see, and it's not even that they knew the planets. They're talking, of course, of the sun and the moon. And they're including that in their 9. So to deal with that, given their limitations, they invent a 10th, and that's called the counter-Earth, which you simply can't see because it's on the other side. Very interesting point. Now, Aristotle gives 3 doctrines as he goes through, which have to do with just this relation of numbers and things, because it's very important for philosophy and it's very important for science. On one hand, all things are numbers, that's metaphysics, which is quoted there. And then there's the archai of mathematics. And the claim there is that the first principle of mathematics and the first principle of all things are really then going to be elements of numbers and therefore the elements of all things. And again, things as they are exist as a kind of imitation or mimesis of the numbers. All right. Now, the object of the review, however, and Aristotle himself is giving us a review as we're reviewing his review, is to learn from these philosophers what they suppose to be principles and how these fall under the causes that are named. Now, that takes, and we had a list of that in class, but it's a fairly important and challenging one because they're still talking about metaphysical attributions to the limited and the unlimited, the even and the odd, and the very idea that the one proceeds from both of these because the one is both even and odd according to one theory, and number comes from the one because one generates out of one the two and so on. And again, he says, as has been said, the whole heaven is numbers. Others will say that there's the 10 and they make in a little pattern and arrangement with respect to that. And we have an illustration of that here, the limited and the unlimited. Odd and even, and those lists already exist, and Aristotle himself is repeating that one and plurality, right and left, male and female, resting and moving, straight, curved, light, dark, good, bad, square, oblong. So on this side of the unlimited are things which are then even, plurality, female, dark, bad. These are regarded as not so ideal, the oblong, rectangular, as opposed to the one, the male, etc., light, good, and square. Four square and so on, that kind of thing. There are then value judgments that go along with these distinctions. And the claim is that human affairs go in pairs, and therefore any chance contrarieties, things which are this rather than that, meaning black and white, sweet and bitter, good and bad, great and small, are then going to be excluded, but ordered one to another. And we also mentioned that this then leads to the, for at least the theologians following Pythagoras, following Plato, and that would particularly be in the wake of Plotinus, that this is an illustration from Flood's discussion of mundane music or the music of the world, the monochord of the world, and you see God's hand sort of adjusting the tension of the string, and you can also see all things that are starting with earth and water, air and fire, and going all the way up, of course, to the sun right there in the center and so on up to the heavens. So there's really a lot more there. We're not going to be able to go utterly through all of this just because this is a review. And we're going to touch on some of these names. Melissus, we won't mention, but we will mention Xenophanes, or a little bit we could mention because Nietzsche talks about him, Parmenides certainly, and that will take us to Heraclitus. Heraclitus is probably the most popular pre-Socratic philosopher. Everybody loves him, maybe because of the boots, but anyway, we're pretty sure that this is Heraclitus. Now, in addition to the symptoms that are made, systems as Aristotle's calling them, he goes to and mentions the philosophy of Plato, which follows obviously after Parmenides and Gorean tradition, but has its own distinctions because Plato was first familiar with Cratylus and the Heracleitean doctrine. Plato's the source of the statement that everything's change, which is attributed to Heraclitus, Pantarei, everything flows, and that there's no knowledge. But these were views that Plato maintained, but Socrates was concerned with the nature of the human, ethical matters, what you should be, how you should be, and therefore ignored to a certain extent the world of nature, because what he was really looking for was universal rules for human beings, how a human being should live his or her life. And Plato accepted that, but then suggested that you would still be able to have these, and we've emphasized this already several times, ideas, whereby sensible things would be copies of ideas, and they would therefore participate in them, but they would not be them. And that's very important. These many multiple things existed by participation in the ideas that have the same name as they, only the name participation was new, that's added because the Pythagoreans used that term, mimesis. And Plato says participation, but doesn't really clarify how that works according to Aristotle. Then he goes on to say that you also have this question in addition to sensible things and forms. This can help you understand if you read some of the later parts of the Republic, which weren't assigned, but which you might want to read, because there the question is they're going to occupy intermediate positions and differ in being eternal and unchangeable, but the form itself is in every case unique. So the forms are the causes. Plato therefore thinks that the elements are the elements of all things, and of course matter, the one, when from great and small by participation in the one, come the numbers for Plato. Now, metaphysics alpha goes on, etc. There's really a lot there. So at this point, we want to turn and think a little bit about Nietzsche philosophy in the tragic age of the Greeks. Now, if we talk now about Nietzsche's philosophy in the tragic age of the Greeks, we have this idea that Nietzsche underlines for us when we begin reading this, that the Greeks are worth paying attention to, but why? And one of the things that he suggests is they've got this quality, the reason we need to pay attention to them is because of philosophy. And they justify it because of the way that they engage in it, and they do so more fully than any other people. Now, the minute he says this, he almost seems to retract it, because he says, look, everybody knows. And already as Nietzsche is writing this, and this is in the early 1870s when he's teaching, and he's lecturing 1873 in giving this in Bayreuth as part of the Wagner festivals, pointing out this very, very initial thing that, look, no one says the Greeks are unique in that they invented all of this. Instead, everyone knows that they found and learned a great deal from the East, from the Orient, and of course, Egypt and so on. But he says, if you put together the places where they're supposed to have learned everything that they learned with what they then develop, it's a little odd. Because if you look at the teachers from the Orient and the Greeks, and you put them side by side, you still have your work cut out for you. So Zoroaster, put him next to Heraclitus. Still going to want to look a lot at Heraclitus. The Hindus next to the Eleatics, you will still want to look at the Eleatics. Egyptians next to Empedocles, or even Anaxagoras, who you would have good reason to putting amidst the Jews, maybe the Babylonian tradition, and you still will find something worthwhile in Anaxagoras and Pythagoras amidst the Chinese. So his point is, by putting these things side by side, you don't get light. You shed light neither on the source traditions that you're talking about, nor indeed on the pre-Socratic. So there is still a question. The Greeks learn a lot, but something else is needed. And that, he suggests, requires an admission. First, nothing would be sillier than to claim an autochthonous development for the Greeks. Crucial point. Why? They invariably absorbed other living cultures. And that's, I think, a very important point. The reason they got so far is that they knew how to pick up the spear and throw it onward from the point where others had left it. They're indebted to these others, these other cultures, these other traditions across the globe, in effect, but they go further. And that's what's intriguing. Meaning, and Nietzsche calls it, the art of fruitful learning, to learn from others and do something with what they learned. Very, very crucial. His claim is you really, for us moderns, we could clarify, we ought to be learning from our neighbors as the Greeks learned from theirs, not for the sake of learned pedantry, but using everything we learn as a foothold, which will take us up as high and even higher than our neighbor. Now, on 32, that's the page numbers that we have here, all of these ancient philosophers, these philosophers in the tragic age, form the republic of creative minds. And Schopenhauer makes a distinction by saying there are scholars and there are creative minds. There are scholars who know all the details and all the facts, and then there are creative minds. These are giants, and the metaphor is the one that Schopenhauer is using, whereby the giants call to the other giants across over the desolate intervals of time. We're going to need that when we think about, obviously, when we think about Augustine and time. Undisturbed by the wanton noises of the dwarfs that creep past beneath them, their high spirit converse continues. And that high spirit converse is the converse of mind to mind. Like to like, which is also a principle that the Greeks emphasized. You have to be related to someone, you have to be akin to someone in order to be able to understand them. So, section two, we read, go get yourselves a culture. Only then will you find out what philosophy can and will do. And that's interesting. So the Greeks had a culture, and philosophy could do something for them. If we get ourselves a culture, maybe we can learn to understand what philosophy can and will do for us. Now, he goes on, and the reason to look at this is really a repetition, because just as we just went over with Aristotle, all of these thinkers of the first principle or the cause, Nietzsche does something similar, but he gives us different accounts. Diogenes Laertius, Nietzsche is an expert in Diogenes Laertius, and he's the author of The Lives and Opinions of Eminent Philosophers, tells us this little anecdote about Thales, who, among all the other things, his origin, his pedigree, as we already talked about that, said there's no difference between being alive and being dead, no difference between life and death. And you can imagine the people made fun of him for that. They did. Why then, said someone to him, why don't you die? And his response is, it does make no difference. There's no reason why. Father, it's the same. Very important point. Nietzsche in section three, if we go on, seems to begin, and this is obviously the reference to Thales, with an absurd notion. And that's exactly the way he's really referring to what we just went over in Aristotle. Water is the primal origin and the womb of all things. So this generative notion of moisture is already in Aristotle, and Nietzsche's pointing out it's a little absurd. Okay. There we have one of our replications of Thales, and we can take a look on page 39 at Nietzsche's question, why should we even bother talking all this water? Why take that seriously? It's serious, he says, for three reasons. First, because it tells us something about the primal origin of all things. Second, this is significant given the antiquity of the thought. It does so in language devoid of image or fable. It's not mythical. And finally, contained in it, if only embryonically, is the thought, all things are one. So the first reason that we've already seen really still leaves Thales in the company of the religious and the superstitious. Namely, go back to that there, primal origin, where does everything come from? You know, who made the world, would still be God. The second takes him out of the company because there's now no reference to gods, and shows him as a natural scientist, looking at the connections that Aristotle's able to talk about. And it's the third, however, that makes him the first Greek philosopher, that is, the one who's going to say what all things are. That means he's speaking metaphysically concerning what is the case for everything. Philosophy now gets a definition in Nietzsche. It's what leaps ahead on tiny toeholds. It doesn't need much. It's sort of a very, very quick mountain climber. Hope and intuition lend wings to its feet. Calculating reason is much more clumsy. It lumbers heavily behind. It looks for better footholds. For reason also wants that alluring goal, but philosophy, being divine, has long since already attained to that. Here the example in Nietzsche was in Switzerland at the time, so he spent as much time as he could in the mountains. He gives an example of mountain climbers standing before a wild mountain stream that's tossing boulders along its course. One of them is good at climbing, the other one not so good. One of them light-footedly leaps over it, that'll be the philosopher, using the rocks to cross, even though after touching those rocks just fall and others can't really follow because the leap dislodges the foothold. The other stands helpless. He can't jump that way, and all the rocks have been moved by the philosopher, so he has to build himself a foundation. We're going to do that when we get to Descartes, which will carry his heavy, cautious steps. Occasionally, this is impossible, and then there exists no God who can help him across. So the philosopher, then, for Nietzsche, is not a man of intellect, if what we mean by intellect will be someone who is able to use his mind to do things in life more efficiently. So that's a really important point. It's something that we can overlook. Aristotle says, and Nietzsche quotes Aristotle, that what Thales and Anaxagoras know is unusual, astonishing, difficult, divine, but never useful. Why? Because it's good for nothing. Their concern was not with the good of humanity. They weren't trying to improve the human condition. In that way, philosophy, Nietzsche goes on to explain, is distinguished from science by its selectivity and discrimination of the unusual, the astonishing, the difficult, and the divine, just as it's distinguished from intellectual cleverness by its emphasis on the useless. Thus, that's the conclusion to his section there, Thales had seen the unity of all that is, but when he went to communicate it, he found himself talking about water. Okay. Here we move to Anaximander in Nietzsche's text and his Belotti's painting, which isn't dated. We can tell it's a painting of Anaximander because Anaximandros is what's written on the page he's holding in his hand. And that's what Nietzsche gives us. He says, look, you got the archetype of the philosopher with Thales and its shifting mists, but his great successor speaks more plainly because Anaximander is the author of the first philosophical fragment. He's the author of the first philosophical text. And what's interesting, she tells us, is that he writes just as one expects a typical philosopher to write when alienating demands have not yet robbed him of his innocence and naivete. He writes in grave and stylized letters, sentence after sentence, the witness to fresh illumination, each the expression of time spanned in sublime meditation. Each single thought and its form is a milestone upon the path to the highest wisdom. You can go over the fragment of Anaximander, the saying of Anaximander, again and again. There's an enormous amount in just a few words, almost as if it were carved, as Nietzsche says, in stone. And we have also, very interesting, an image of Anaximandros right here, carved in stone. And this carving, this engraved name, and this profile seems to be the source for Raphael's School of Athens, and right there by the edge of the door, because this is, of course, painted on the wall. So if you were to find that figure, you can be sure that one, at least maybe you know, that seems to be Anaximander. And of course, also Belotti's painting also includes this piece of paper on which he seems to be writing. Why? Because we've got this saying that's written down, and that is very important. This is a characteristic of this thinker, because this thinker is the first one who has written philosophy for us. Okay. So what's that extant fragment? It's called a fragment or a saying, but of course it's not found on the dust somewhere. It's written down, copied again and again in Simplicius and Theophrastus. And we read, and this is Nietzsche's rendering, whence things have their origin, there they must also pass away according to necessity, for they must pay penalty and be judged for their injustice according to the ordinance of time. So one of the things is that origin, from whence, and thus to which things will pass away, is bound up with penalty and justice as a corrective for injustice according to the ordinance of the rule of time. So existence seems to have the characteristics of a crime that needs to be expiated. Nietzsche says, enigmatic, and he couldn't be more right, proclamation of a true pessimist, oracular legend over the boundary stone of Greek philosophy. How shall we interpret you? How are we going to do that? Now, he's got Schopenhauer, who's a pessimist, and he's got the Vedic tradition, and all of these seem to weigh in on Anaximander, where, this is the quote from Schopenhauer, the proper measure with which to judge any and all human beings is that they're really creatures who shouldn't exist at all, and who are doing penance for their lives, for their manifold sufferings, and their death. So we're talking a little bit about karma. What could we expect of such creatures? Are we not all sinners under the sentence of death? We do penance for having been born, first by living, and then by dying. That gives us a lot to think about. So Nietzsche says, okay, it mayn't be logical, but it is human to view, together with Anaximander, all coming to be, coming into existence, as though it were an illegitimate emancipation from eternal being. Think of the reference to Parmenides, what is, and therefore excludes any possible becoming or possible change. And from that perspective, it's a wrong for which destruction is the only penance. Everything that has ever come to be again passes away, whether we think of human life or of water or of hot and cold. Wherever definite qualities are perceivable, we can prophesy upon the basis of enormously extensive experience the passing away of these qualities. Now, that is the aperon. That's Anaximander's word, the indefinite. Nietzsche's explication is really a gloss on that idea of the aperon, and of course also a challenge. How are you going to define that? Never, and references still to Parmenides, never can a being which possesses definite qualities or consists of such be the origin or first principle of things, because where would you get the change? That which truly is, concludes Anaximander, cannot possess definite qualities, so the indefinite has to be what the aperon means, the indefinite, or it would come to be and pass away like all other things. So everything that has definite qualities comes into being, defined in that way, and is abolished, pays penance on the same token for having been so defined. So in order that coming to be shall not cease, so that you've got a continuous source of generation of existence, primal being must be indefinite. Defined being comes out of the undefined. So the immortality and everlastingness of primal being does not lie in its infinity or infinitude or its inexhaustibility, but rather, so he's countering the commentators, but in the fact that it's devoid of definite qualities, because those defined qualities are the problem, and they would lead to its passing away, because defined qualities over time become indefinite. They lose their definition, hence the name, the indefinite. So definition comes out of the indefinite and passes away again, according to the order of time, into the indefinite. So, named in that way, primal being is superior, ensuring thereby eternity and the unimpeded course of coming to be. The ultimate unity of the indefinite, the womb of all things, can be designated by human speech only as a negative. Ah is a primitive, the alpha privative is a negation, a negative, something to which the existent world of coming to be can give no predicate. So we can look at it as the equal of the Kantian Ding an sich, the thing in itself. We're going to need a little reference to that when we're reading Kant. So instead now, we look at that sentence one more time. It's a lapidary sentence, as if carved in stone, as he already said, recognizing that we are not quite looking at the origin of the world in a purely physical way. Rather, when Anaximander sees in the multiplicity of things that have come to be a sum of injustices, he grasps with bold fingers the tangle of the most profound problem in ethics. He was the first Greek to do this. His question is, how can anything pass away which has a right to? So if you're right to exist, why would you then not endure in existence? Very interesting question. Extraordinary question. And he continues that. He gives a question to this insight. What's your existence worth? He says, if it's worthless, why are you here? And he gives an answer to his own question, to the question to Anaximander. Your guilt, I see, causes you to tarry in your existence. You make it worse rather than passing away quickly. You hang on. With your death, you have to expiate it. Look how your earth is withering, how your seas are diminishing and drying up. Because, of course, Anaximander also points to just the same almost physical and empirical details. The seashell on the mountaintop can show you how much has dried up already, just if you look at the traces of passing away. Even now, fire is destroying your world. Someday, it'll go up in fumes and smoke. But ever and anew, another such world of ephemerality will construct itself. Who's there that could redeem you from the curse of coming to be? Phillies had demonstrated, as Nietzsche says on page 49, the need to simplify the realm of the many, reducing it to the mere unfolding or masking of the one and only existent quality, water, everything being really made of water. Anaximander now takes two steps beyond him. First, he says, how can you have the many? How can you have such diversity if there's such a thing as the eternal one, just water? And he takes his answer from the self-contradictory, self-consuming and negating character of the many. Its existence, all this plurality, becomes for him a moral phenomenon, not justified, not rectified, no right to exist as it is, but which expiates itself forever through its passing. So there's a justice that comes into effect by perishing. Perishing is not a terrible thing. Perishing is corrective. But then he has another question, which is the problem with the eternity of the world. Even Kant is going to be concerned with the same question. Where does eternity come from? Where does the fact that there seems to have been being coming into being for a rather long time, maybe an infinite amount of time already? So the question, why hasn't all that came to be passed away long since a whole eternity of time has passed? Whence the ever-renewed stream of coming to be? Where does it all come from? And from this question, he's able to save himself only by a mystic possibility. Eternal coming to be can have its origin only in eternal being. The conditions for the fall from being to coming to be in injustice are forever the same. The constellation of things is such that no end can be envisaged for the emergence of individual creatures from the womb of the indefinite. Once again, we remember that what is definite being this rather than that, that comes out of the indefinite and in the course of time loses that definition only to pass away again into the indefinite. That's page 50, which takes him to Heraclitus. Wow. Lawful order, unfailing certainties, ever like orbia of lawfulness, erinnes, those are the fates, the kindly ones, or the furies sometimes called, sitting in judgment on all transgressions against lawful order, the whole world, the spectacle of sovereign justice, and of the demonically ever-present natural forces that serve it, not the punishment of what has come to be, did I see, but the justification of that which is coming into being. Now, Nietzsche's judgment on Heraclitus of Ephesus is to say, you've got pride here, hubris, apostasy. When did that ever reveal itself in inviolable forms, in laws held sacred, where injustice rules? There are caprice, disorder, lawlessness, contradiction. But where law and Zeus's daughter Dike, justice rules alone, as they do in this world, how could there be the sphere of guilt, of penance, of judgment? How could this world that we see all around us be the execution arena of all that is condemned? Okay, big, big question. And from that intuition, as Nietzsche's ascribing this to Heraclitus, you have two connected negations. Only through comparison with the doctrines of his predecessor can we understand this. So we need Anaximander in order to be able to understand very dark sayings. Heraclitus is called the obscure. He's a very difficult philosopher. We need him. First of all, he denied the duality of totally diverse worlds, a position which Anaximander had been compelled to assume. For Heraclitus, everything is in contradiction with itself, constantly in tension, all the time. So Heraclitus no longer distinguished a physical world from a metaphysical world, a realm of definite qualities from an undefinable indefinite. And after this step, nothing could keep him or hold him back from a second, far bolder negation. Heraclitus altogether denied being. So there's nothing that is, everything is becoming. Everything is constant change. For this one world, which he retains, supported by eternal unwritten laws, flowing upward and downward, both, of course, in a brazen rhythmic beat, both, of course, nowhere shows a tarrying, an indestructibility, a bulwark in the stream. You've got nothing to hang on to. Louder than Anaximander, Heraclitus proclaimed, I see nothing other than becoming. Be not deceived. It's the fault of your myopia, not the nature of things. If you believe you see land somewhere in the ocean of coming to be and passing away, it's just flux. And of course, that's also what Plato says. Heraclitus, this is also ascribed to Heraclitus, page 53. You use names for things as though they were rigidly, persistently endured. Heraclitus writes about the logos, the names, the words, yet even the stream into which you step a second time is not the one you stepped into before. So how can you give it a name, a single name? Heraclitus does this in dicta like, we've already alluded a bit to that, everything forever has its opposite along with it, and in such unabashed fashion that Aristotle accused him of the highest crime before the tribunal of reason, to have sinned against the law of contradiction. But intuitive thinking embraces two things. One, the present many-colored and changing world that crowds in upon us in all of our experiences of the world in its flux. And two, the conditions which alone make any experience of this world possible. And this is a reference to Kant. And we're going to see this when we read the Prolegomena, time and space. Very important. They may be perceived intuitively. This is this question of Anschauung, as Kant talks about it, even without a definite content, independent of all experience, purely in themselves. We can have this, bring this, and impose this on experience. Now, he's also got help from Schopenhauer, because Schopenhauer can clarify, very importantly, that only by way of its acts does reality fill space and time. Its activity upon the immediate object conditions the intuitive perception which alone it has existence. The consequence of the activity of any material object upon another is recognized only insofar as the latter now acts differently from what it did before upon the immediate object's reality. It's nothing other than this. Cause and effect, that's a vehicle. In other words, make out the whole nature of materiality, cause and effect, action, reaction, its being, its activity. This is why in German, of course, Schopenhauer's writing in German, Nietzsche's writing in German, the epitome of all materiality is properly called Wirklichkeit, which means wirken, to act on something, a word that is much more apt than Realität, which comes out of the realia of the Latin. That goes on to explain that upon which it acts is likewise invariably matter. So Its whole being and nature consists only in the orderly changes which one of its parts produces in another. Reality, therefore, actuality, therefore, is completely relative in accord with a relationship that's valid only within its bounds. One more time, the reference to Kant. Schopenhauer is also referring to Kant, exactly as is time, exactly as is space. So, everlastingly, then, a given quality contends against itself, separating into its opposites. Everlastingly, the opposites seek to reunite. Ordinary people think they see something rigid, complete, and permanent, but in truth, you've got everything. You've got light and dark, bitter and sweet, attached to each other and interlocked at any given moment, like wrestlers of whom sometimes the one, sometimes the other is dominant, is on top. Honey, says Heraclitus, is at the same time bitter and sweet. The world itself is a mixed drink which must constantly be stirred. So that strife gives birth to what comes to be the definite qualities which look permanent, really express only the momentary ascendancy of one partner. But that's not the end of the war, because the contest endures in all eternity. Everything that happens, happens in accord with strife, polemos, war, which is of course what Heraclitus is talking about. And it is in this strife that eternal justice is revealed. Very interesting notion, because the strife is also harmony, tension, one thing opposed against, and therefore harmoniously in accord with itself. So welling up from the purest strings of Hellenism, the idea that strife embodies the everlasting sovereignty of strict justice bound to everlasting laws.